Germany calling. Here are the Reichsender ambush. Station Bremen and station DXB on the 31-meter band. You are about to hear our news in English.
Hello, Mr. and Mrs. America and all the ships at sea. Had it not been for the war, Hitler would have done well. Which is like saying, if it had not been for the Jews, Hitler would have been redundant. Almost without reservation, Lord Horror approved of the man. Hitler's achievements were only now being fully understood. In the mythical identification with which leaders in the West had invested in him, and in the role model France and England and America had found in what they thought was his new conservatism, that these nations had totally misunderstood, both his stance in iron intransigence in the face of adversity, was hardly his fault. History rewrites itself with or without its main protagonist. Unblinking Lord Horror, the English radio broadcaster, gazed out into the fierce Burmese sunlight. It was 7:30 ante-meridian, yet already, though the month was only April, there was a solid humidity in the air. Only the occasional breath of wind blowing in from the ocean, stirring the stems of the newly drenched orchids hanging from the eaves of the station veranda, provided relief. Horror scanned the sky for sign of the airship. His bones felt hollow, and he wiped a clawed hand across his forehead. Another migraine was brewing. He began to hum an old sentimental tune to himself. The words floated in his head like clouds of bee sperm, whilst deeper thoughts awoke in him memories of time long spent.
Of things I should be grateful for, I've had a goodly share.
How intimately strange death is. The more you think about it, the sooner it happens.
And as I sit in the comfort of a cozy chair,
I lapse into a terrible reverie.
My fancy takes me to a humble east side tenement, 3 flights in the rear, where my childhood days were spent.
I think about everyone dying.
It wasn't much like paradise, but amidst the dirt and all, there sat the sweetest angel, one that I fondly call.
We live life to say yes to death.
My Yiddish mama, I need you more than ever now.
We manage to function. The thought of death paralyzes the weak. Its threat deep and real.
My Yiddish mama, I'd love to kiss that wrinkled brow.
We drive a car. We fly a plane.
I long to hold her hand once more, as I did in days gone by.
We live our lives to death's invisible fugue, but by mutual consent, it is something people hide from each other, no more so than in the death camps.
And ask her to forgive me for things I did that made her cry.
True, all true.
How few were her pleasures. She never cared for fashion style. Her jewels and treasures she found amid my baby's smile.
Don't you see the enormity of what's been done?
Oh, I know that I owe what I am today.
against the chaos of my soul.
To that dear little lady.
The more people you kill, the easier becomes the pain of life. So the theory goes.
So old and gray. To that wonderful Yiddish show. Yiddish show.
Had he been younger and still in regimental service, the tune would have been a more sober one. He had watched Izzy Bond sing the song in the open air on Wigan Pier. That day had smelt as bittersweet as his hot and humid one. For a moment he was back on stage at the Oldham Empire, on the same boards that had once carried Lily Langtry and Vesta Tilly. In the matinee he had sung a lovely duet with Gracie Fields, the last from nearby Rochdale, cleverly rhyming moon with June. In his solo spot, he had sung a lugubrious version of A Bodkin on the Bounce, which had been appreciated not only by the Brompton Street regulars in the stalls, but also by the gentry from the Compass and the Gods. Oldham, Manchester, London, Dublin, New York, Berlin. Where would his destiny fall? Lord Hara opened his pop eyes on the glare of the still empty sky. He was dressed in as little of the regulation army khaki as possible. Despite this, his skin, yellow and leathery with age, gleamed with sweat. His body was slim to the point of emaciation. Parts of him, like his unusually thick lips, were oddly rotund and effeminate.
I rounded them off just for you, baby.
His beaked nose could be Jewish. The tall sides of his skull were hairless. His scalp, freckled and shiny, stretched tightly over bone. From the apex of his head spouted a dense clump of red, wiry hair. He broke off pacing to snatch a few leaves of betel from a lacquered box on his desktop. He raised the bright red leaves to his lips and snapped them irritably into his mouth. The sullen hot steam rising from the foliage about the river would soon be unbearable. Already the wafts of wind blowing in from the ocean were smelling sweet indeed, and Lord Hara felt the pleasure of lost love of the Lady Libya Major move over him in a dark, smoldering wave. Y'all say labia in this country. A Libya Minor, a Libya Major is the meatiest, the big part of the pussy, and the Libya Minor is those little lips on the inside, and then that the hole is called the vestibule of the vagina. Did you know that? He drew quickly back from the sky, as though he had seen beyond its blueness, into the electron minuet of the borealis light. There was positively no sign of the Frenchman. He decided he would wait outside. Stepping from his equatorial eyrie, he immediately set himself on a path that wound through his gardens. Hara walked through the necromantic scents like some large nectar-sucking bird savoring his kingdom. He thrust his hands more deeply into the pockets of his shorts. His unplugged headphones had dropped around his neck and were emitting a continuous soft hissing as they responded to the plant radiations. His mood was not the stuff of irony. Rather, it was to be concerned with the process of cooling blood in readiness for future time. Above him, human bodies were hanging. The bodies were suspended in the branches of the trees. They were naked, in various stages of death and decay. Some had been placed there long ago and were old and dried. Others, younger and fresher, were still weeping and decomposing. A few were still alive, stirring feebly in their bonds, attached to branches by copper wires. Their limbs outstretched like starfish. Lord Hara effected elemental contact by standing beneath the recently killed coolie. The sound from his headphones changed to a wild, trilling noise, and when he tapped the phones with a finger, the carps jigged around in a bizarre fashion. Sparks of electricity moved over its skin and flowed outward along the cable, linking it to the next body some yards away. The second body began in turn to jerk. Much older than the first, It had been reduced almost to bone, and flex had been twined crudely about its torso to hold it in shape. About a dozen such bodies were hung in the branches, arranged in a circle, each connected to the other by a cable. They formed a circuit along which the current flowed. Lord Har gave a few more taps to the phones. The bodies shook violently, disturbing a large group of livid red macaws, which rose into the sunlight in a noisy swarm and flew off above the leafy canopies. He could remember a time when he lacked no shortage of volunteers. He did not have to resort to repairing the bodies as he did now, and volunteers not used as conductors had readily provided other pleasures. Under the tropical sun, he had disemboweled many of the young Jewesses, who had been brought in by ship from Poland and Russia. After the dispatching, Lord Hara had skinned them down. Sometimes he fashioned a mask from the dead women's skin and fastened it over his face. In the right mood, he wore their private parts as jewelry. He plaited together the breasts of a dozen different women and wore them in a soft bronze scarf around his shoulders. If the sun was particularly flattering, he clipped their vaginas to his ears so that they swished gently in the warm breeze.
Yeah, the big V-lube.
The soft labials brushed his rouged cheeks, carrying a delicate oceanographic smell to his nostrils. With a steel dagger, he hollowed out the bone and gristle from an amputated Jewess's foot and wore it over his exposed penis as a pouch. Hidden away in the Jew's physiognomy were all the necessary materials he could possibly wear during his lifetime. He knew that he could literally live off the Jew. The essential essences and salts surged through the Jew, and surely no meat tasted sweeter. At other times, at night beneath the waning moon, he imagined he was a powerful giant straddling the earth, wearing a lunar necklace of Jews that stretched to the moon and Neptune, Milky Way, and the vastness that wandered beyond. In such moments, the cosmic voice of the Jew seemed to speak to him from the eternal universe. The rings of human remains acted like electromagnetic cells, focusing the emanations from the plants and transforming their power. Many years ago, in experiments conducted in the death camps, Dr. Mengele had discovered that human beings made the best transformers. About 100 clusters of cells, each arranged in groups of 30, were strung symmetrically around Hara's Pacific Lunar Isle, together forming a monumental aeratorial transmitter.
Negro from the London Docks sings the blackout blues. I hate to see the evening sun go down. Hate to see the evening sun go down. Cause the German, he done bombed this town.
His broadcast indeed covered nations. His voice cajoled all areas of the globe and beyond. Languidly, he wiped his forehead. It seemed like yesterday when he had first broadcast from the Reichsrundfunk at the Rundfunk House. I just say, funk you. Right in your Reich hole. His voice had been the prelude to the evacuation of the Sudetenland. His words alone had sealed the fate of Czechoslovakia. Under the bilious spell of Horro's ochlocratic speech, the Slovak premier, Dr. Joseph Tiso, had proclaimed the founding of the autonomous Slovak Republic. This had been followed immediately by the full Nazi invasion of his country. Hara traveled personally with Hitler and had been among the first to arrive at the Hradkany, the ancient castle in Prague. Under the protection of the Führer's entourage and SS guards, he had raced at speed through the night over the icy roads. On arrival, he was told to select the most suitable officers to assist both himself and Hitler in making broadcasts direct to the Czech nation. After he had eliminated the hated Jew and interned dissidents in Petrhek prison, Himmler proclaimed himself profoundly impressed by both the dedication and fanaticism of Haro's radio speeches.
Exceptional human material, Herr Hara. If you should ever relinquish the role of broadcaster, you will be made most welcome in the Waffen-SS.
Hara felt satisfaction that Hitler had selected a far more prestigious role for him. He was sure that Hitler had developed a warm affection towards him. In the early years, he traveled constantly with the Führer, often in the company of Hitler's two closest advisors, Speer and Bormann. He witnessed Hitler in every conceivable circumstance, in times of fortune and misfortune, in victory and defeat, in good cheer and in angry outburst. During speeches and conferences, surrounded by thousands, by a mere handful, or quite alone. Speaking on the telephone, sitting in his bunker, in his car, in his plane. Even so, he could not claim to have seen into Hitler's soul or perceive what he was after. Hara commenced broadcasting to England under the nom de plume Lord Haw Haw. He played Vera Lynn, Anne Shelton, the Lily Marlene girl, Ambrose in his orchestra. His polemical broadcasts regularly interrupted the light programs ITMA and Bandstand with news of the atrocities perpetrated by the withdrawing Allied troops. He interviewed Hess on his triumphant return to Germany, giving the lie to Churchill's propaganda broadcast to the Fatherland. To England, he hosted musical soirees, an outside broadcast from the gas chambers of Auschwitz, Belsen, and Buchenwald.